Webhooks are incredibly powerful automation tools, but most people misunderstand them. In this video, I will cut through that confusion and show you exactly how webhooks work so that you can use them more effectively in your automation. One of the best ways to understand webhooks is to see it as a way for one system to send information to another system. So you have your app A, and something happens and app A needs to communicate that to app B. So let's jump into n8n and gradually let us understand from the n8n perspective how webhooks work. So if you come into this place, your nodes, and you look for webhook, so you're going to see two options. The webhook, this one is what triggers your workflow to start whenever it is called, and this helps you to return data whenever that webhook is called. So let's select this first one, which is the webhook. So I'm going to break down exactly the different parameters that are here. So the first one is your webhook URLs. Like I said, think about it as the post office having your address. So this is the address, your URL. So you have two options. You have the test URL, you have the production URL. Now the test URL, basically, if you look at it, it has your address here. This is my cloud address. And you can see the next option after the slash there is the webhook-test. Then you can see this is a unique value that makes, because all your webhooks, they have to be unique. Remember, it's an address. You need to know where you're sending that data to. Now, if you open the other tab, which is the production URL, it is basically the same thing, except that here you just have the webhook, while here you have webhook test. Then you can see this value here, this unique value here is the same, it's exactly the same thing as the path you have here. So I can also change this. I can change this to form submit, or just change it to anything, and you can see automatically this place has changed. It is advisable to make it things that you can easily remember instead of playing around with alphanumeric values. Now, the next parameter here is your HTTP method. Now, I'm going to explain two of these HTTP methods, the GET and the POST. But I'm going to tell you right now that 90% of your automations are going to be using POST. Most times when you use GET, it's usually for testing purposes, right? It has very, very limited use cases. Most people use it for testing, as we are going to use in this case. So we are going to explain this GET method. Now, the next parameter is the authentication. Most times when you are using webhooks, the authentication is usually none. But you can also add a basic authentication, which if you then say create new credential, it allows you to enter a username and password. The same thing with when you want to create a header auth or you have your JWT auth token. But in this particular case, you're just going to go with none. Most times when you're doing webhooks, the authentication here will be none. There are other options under this respond. You can have when this webhook is triggered, respond immediately, respond when a node finishes, or using webhook to respond. So we're also going to look at this case, this option as time goes on. Now the next option, the next parameter here is the options. Under the options, there are different values you can allow here. In this video, I'll just talk about the ignore bots. The ignore bots allow, I think this is a very good parameter to turn on, right? It allows you to prevent web crawlers, because remember, once somebody has your address, the person can just send you a webhook request. So you want to prevent automated callers to reach out to your webhooks, except of course, maybe your automation wants stuff like that. The next one I want to talk about is your IP whitelist. IP is used to limit the source of the data should be coming from. And you can also have where field name for binary data. Of course, you know, the binary data is your, like your zeros and ones, especially for images or for audio files. So let's take a closer look at this URL. So again, this is a GET method. You have this URL. So if I copy this URL and if I take that and I say listing and I want to send a message to my webhook. So I just load this. You can see it says message workflow has started. So if I select this pretty print, it just makes it a bit better. If you come back to your workflow, you can see that it has received that message. Basically, you have headers, you have parameters, params, right? Or you have query, you have the body. You can see the webhook URL. You can see this is your webhook URL. So this is the data your n8n workflow has received. The execution mode is test. So under the headers, it basically just gives you the information. You can see the information about the device that made that request to the webhook. You can see the cookies, basically just a lot of information about this. You can see the ex-forwarded IP is there, and you can just basically get information. You can see it shows you the Google Chrome, it shows you the type of browser this person used. So this can be like really good information, especially when you are pulling information and you're doing some analysis around this. Now, the next thing you can also have, I can also add a query parameter. So I can come to this web URL. Once I put a question mark, it means I want to add a query to it. So I can put first name, okay, there's already something here. I can put first name equals K and put this ampersand and say last name equals Bucci. So let me, first of all, let me make sure I'm listening here. Then I come here. If I send this out, you're going to, again, workflow has started. Then you're going to see this new information that you can see here. First name is K, last name is Bucci. One other ways I can also test is I can start listening here, come to my terminal and do like a call request, right? A call request is a way of browsing the web via your terminal or command prompt. So if I send this out, you can see workflow has started. And if you can see here, this time around, the user agent is no longer the browser. The user agent is now call, right? So it basically gives you that information, the same IP address. Then of course you then see, let me move this out here. You can then see this is still the test webhook URL and the execution mode is still test. So now that we've explored the webhook node, let's explore the respond to webhook. So this ensures that you are able to respond to the webhook. Remember to make sure that your response here is using respond to webhook node. Remember that webhook basically is unidirectional. So sending out messages, sending out notification, right? This respond to webhook makes it bidirectional. So here I can decide to, okay, respond with incoming request. So when I come in here, let me execute a workflow. If I execute this workflow and I come back here, let's submit this data. You can see it has responded. You can see that data that I normally would have gotten from here. You can see it responded with that data here. So pretty print. You can see the params, the query, the body. So let's say, let me add query. Let me say name equals K, right? So come in here, execute the workflow so that it starts listening. So we send this out and you can see now, if I do the pretty print, you can see the query name is K, which is basically what this information grabbed. Now, there are also other options. You can respond with binary file. Usually when you're dealing with binary file, you're talking of audio images. You can respond with first incoming message. You can have a JSON body response, right? Where you can see message and you can see welcome here. So let's execute the workflow and come back, send this out. Then you can see the message says welcome here. So another option you have here, which is good usually, is a redirect to a given URL, right? So I can redirect it to a given URL. I can say getinvoicesmart.com. So that whenever I execute this workflow, I come back here, I load this, it's then going to redirect the user to that URL. So that's pretty good way to see this workflow work. Now, another very important HTTP method is your post method. The path here is form submit, authentication is still none. Then we need to remove this. You can say respond immediately. So let's disconnect this. Let's look at the post for a while. Now, the post usually is used to, let's say, for example, you're generating leads or you are getting a Stripe notification, maybe a payment has been made. So what you usually do is you send this URL to whatever app that you're expecting that message from. So in this particular case, we are using tally.so, where we created a form. We already have a form, right, that we created under the integration. This is where I'm going to. So in this particular case, I can just delete this, right? Delete this, then you can click on webhooks, say connect. So this is where you're going to say, okay, this is where you copy your URL. So if I copy this URL and I come back to this place, I can add the URL here and I can say connect. Now, of course, it is green, which means it has connected. Now, you can also come here to event logs. It will show you whether events have been received. So you can send out a test event. So one of the things I can start looking, right? Then let me come back to this place and send out a test event. So if I send out a test event, of course, after sending a test event, you can see it was delivered. Then if you come back to your workflow, you can see that test event that it has sent. Now, that contact form, if you look at the contact form, it's supposed to have a first name, it's a last name, and a message or a question. So if you come here, you can see the first name is there, which is K, the second name, Bucci, and the value is hello. So that's another thing you can do to make it cleaner is to add the set node. So if you add a set node, so we can say F name. So what field are we extracting here? We have the webhook. So want this value. So if you come to schema, so want this value. Okay. Add another last. So So one this value, Bucci, and then add another message. Then one this value, that's the message. So if I execute this step, you can see it makes it a lot cleaner. You can see K, Bucci 1000, then your question, are you open weekends? That's a better question, right? So if I submit this and I click submit, that should trigger your workflow. If I open this up, you can see K, first name, last name, Bucci, are you open weekends? Then you can continue to build this out, right? You can then add an AI agent. You can add an AI agent and maybe use that to do any form of processing that you want. So this is Webhooks, and I hope you really got this very simple explanation, and you can take this explanation and use it to begin to build automations for your workflow. Thank you very much for watching this video, and see you in the next. Bye.